turned us into a kind of Frankenstein's monster at best, a toxic force in the body of the Gaian world soul at worst. And I believe that our origin and our future culmination and our present happiness all can be secured, understood, illuminated, and expanded only if we're willing to look at our relationship not only to altered states of consciousness, but to the mind behind nature. Because that's really what this is all about, to my mind. What these psychedelics are empowering or conveying or revealing, depending on, you know, how you come at it, what they are showing us is that we are not alone upon this planet. We are not alone in the universe of mind. And I realize this is a soft audience to preach this in, because there are probably people within the sound of my words who sincerely believe they were once citizens of Zeta Reticuli. You know, it's when the jar is so leaky, it's hard to know where to put the water. But I come to this as a show-me kind of guy. And so, though my conclusions may sound as flaky as anybody else's, it was hard for me to get this flaky. I didn't embrace it. I was forced to it. And this method works. You see, I mean, there are two ways to get flaky. You can just get flaky, which takes no effort at all, you know. I mean, you just announce you're a walk-in, start eating wheatgrass juice, and, you know, tithe to Maitreya. Or you can get flaky by testing the edges, by stretching the envelope of being. And this works for the most hard-headed among us, the aerospace insurance adjuster mentality is not only who I'm speaking to, but who I feel I represent. Because, no kidding, really, at age 18, I was a Marxist, an existentialist. I had ambitions in the field of aeronautical engineering, so forth and so on. And I discovered that you can take that kind of a mentality out into the theater of real experience, and you can come back a space bunny just like everybody else. So what that means then is that a straight person, and I speak as someone from the 60s with apologies to all our gay friends who later appropriated that word, because when I say straight, I mean unstoned. A straight person is not a guardian of truth or probity. A straight person is simply a frightened person. Proto-flake, you see? I always think, and most of you have heard me say this, but when we get off on this subject, I always think about the wonderful thing Tim Leary said years ago. He said it so many years ago that when I told him how much I admired him for saying it, he didn't remember that he'd said it. But the man once said, wait till I give the line, LSD is a drug which occasionally causes psychotic behavior in people who have not taken it. You see? And I certainly saw this. I mean, I saw my parents become violently psychotic from not taking LSD. And so my point is, and I make it in a forum like this, because here we have so much permission for belief. I mean, you want to believe in, you know, channeling from beyond the grave? Fine, no problem. You want to believe in the healing power of nematodes, hematodes, hematite, you name it. We've got it all. Really, I think that the spirit of childlike, untrammeled curiosity is what we're striving for. Not the anal retentive rational person, not the I'll go for anything channeling flake, but an attitude of we don't have to look far for miracles because they're all around us. Everything is astonishing. The universe on its surface is alive with mystery. Well, how do we make our way toward that? When we live in a culture, practice a language, embody a philosophy, scientific rationalism, which is entirely designed to suck wonder out of reality, to turn everything into shades of gray, to subvert all hope that lies outside the realm of career accomplishment and material possession. Well, the way that we can overcome this is through a personal acting out of what I have been calling now for several years the archaic revival. If we had 1,000 years, if we had 500 years, maybe propaganda, messages on boxes of cereal, photographs on cartons of milk, I don't know, something might do it. But we don't have 500 years. We must come to a screeching halt now, because we are barreling toward the brink of ruin. And the only thing that I have ever seen that turned anybody around on the dime was psychedelics. You know? The talking cures invented by Freud and Jung at the beginning of this century, it takes years. Sometimes it never happens. The body work that came along behind that with Wilhelm Reich and others, Feldenkrais and so forth, Ida Roth, all of this brings it into the theater of the body. At least now we understand it's a body-mind system. It's not a disembodied voice lying on a couch speaking, you know. But it seems so obvious. What we're trying to do is perturb the mind. We want to perturb the mind so that we can then see it differently, so that it may see and be seen differently. Well, the mind rests on a foundation of chemical machinery. We're not saying the mind is chemical machinery. We're saying the mind rests on a foundation of chemical machinery. So if you want to perturb the mind, you don't go to the talking. You don't go to the deep tissue. All of this has efficacy, but it is necessary, but not sufficient by itself. For there to be a sufficiency of method, there must be an initial perturbation of the mind. And this comes about through the use of psychedelic plants. This is not something that was discovered post-LSD in Manhattan by psychiatrists or in Prague or Berlin or at Esalen. This is a truth 25,000, 50,000, 100,000 years old. This is how it's always been done. Only in the last 6,000 years, on the European continent and those civilizations that are the children of Europe, has there been any other approach to these problems? Well, and what the other approach, linear thought, the phonetic alphabet, science, mathematical abstraction, so forth and so on, what these other approaches have brought us is toxicity, pollution, mutation, catastrophe, revolution, death, and yes, friends, even unhappiness. It hasn't worked. Western civilization is now crowing over the fact that the only opposition it ever had, which was Marxism, a pathetic, weak sister, has now collapsed upon itself. Well, there should be no congratulation in that, because the contradictions which undid Marxism lie in wait to undo this society as well. Both societies are materialistic. Both societies define human beings and treat them as things. And the fact of the matter is, Western civilization at this moment is a loaded gun pointed at the head of this planet. And we, for all our pretensions to a sensitivity to the presence of vitamin C or zinc in our diet or all the rest of this malarkey, we are the major prevaricators of this situation. So a certain obligation rests upon us. And I think we're meeting this obligation. I wouldn't say we're doing a great job or a terrible job. I think we're functioning at approximately a B-plus level. You see, I mean, human life is so ephemeral. I mean, a person who lives 70 or 80 years is really as ephemeral as a mayfly or something. I mean, it's not long enough to get the full picture. For instance, many of you, by virtue of not having spent a great deal of time thinking about it, probably don't realize that this psychedelic plant shamanism option, this is not something that Western civilization has grappled with for centuries and come to terms with and found the proper pigeonhole for and put aside. Not at all, my friends. The fact of the matter is, all of this information about psychedelics has arrived in Western society in the last 100 years. And we have to say 100 years because we want to include things like mescaline, 1895-98, it began to be studied in Germany, and things like ibogaine, which was known toward the end of the last century, but which has had virtually zilch impact on American psychedelic populations. So we have to say the psychedelic option has only been an object of the Western mind's curiosity for approximately 100 years. But really, 90% of that occurred in the last 50 years. As many of you know, I am a great fan and spokesman for psilocybin, for the mushrooms. The mushrooms that I am so stoked on were discovered in 1953 by Gordon and Valentina Wasson in Watla, discovered in 53, made absolutely Schedule I illegal in 1966. 13 years was the window in which Western civilization had to study this compound and figure out what it was for. And they were just beginning to focus upon it when it was made illegal. LSD, discovered in 37, not brought into the scientific literature until 48, not generally available even in the laboratory until 1950. made totally illegal in 1966. 16-year window. Think about the fact that when LSD was legal, psychiatrists, professional researchers, were consistently reporting cures of chronic alcoholism with one 500 gamma dose. One dose. Cure, like a 50% cure rate without recidivism for chronic alcoholism. Spectacular findings were being reported. When LSD swept through the scientific community, it for pharmacologists, psychotherapists, psychiatrists, it had the same kind of excitement and feeling of breakthrough that the splitting of the atom had for the physicist, for the physics community in the late 30s. Well, science, we are told, is this absolutely impartial, godlike body of knowledge prosecuted by great men, and it will fearlessly send its questing mind into any situation or environment. This is a mental discipline so dispassionate that it sees nothing at all wrong with strapping monkeys into apparatus and hurling them into walls at 70 miles an hour to study traumatic injuries. This is a discipline so unflinching in its pursuit of truth that it will design tiny television cameras to be implanted in plastic penises so that we can see the changes in the color of the vaginal wall as it approaches orgasm. I mean, these guys are unstinting in their devotion to truth in any form. And yet, for 30 years, science has accepted government's refusal to allow science to look at the potential impact of psychedelic plants and compounds on human consciousness, on chronic alcoholism, on schizophrenia, on depression, on autism, on learning disorders, on dyslexias, on memory enhancements, so forth and so on. This to me is obscene. The future is mental. Figure it out. If the mind does not loom large in the future history of this species, then what the hell kind of future is it going to be? I mean, this is our crowning glory, our aesthetic sensitivities, our ability to create values that are not simply based on the next meal, the next sexual encounter, the next empowering social move, but an ability to create social values based on creating a viable future environment for children, creating a viable present environment for the less fortunate among us, creating a social safety net so that the more maladaptive of us are not reduced to living under bridges and in abandoned automobiles. I mean, these are the things which set us above the apes. These are the things which take us out of the context of organic nature and make it seem as though, hey, there actually are some transcendental values being maximized here. There actually is something going on within the human family that if it were to be lost, fumbled away, compromised, or destroyed, the universe would be a poorer. Salvation itself becomes an impediment to salvation. I mean, once you see 500 forms of salvation being sold at prices you can't afford, the very notion of salvation becomes obscene. You know, it becomes one more layer in the obscene layering that takes meaning out of life and disempowers us and turns us into a subscription customer. That seems to be how we always are being forced to end up. Well, the only way out of this, I think, is to... it takes courage, because you have to turn your back on your culture in the most profound sense there is, because there are many ways to turn your back on your culture. I mean, if everyone's wearing gray, you can wear green. That's one way to turn your back on a culture. But another way is to break its laws. Now, that's a little more serious and, you know, brings in big philosophical issues. But in fact, the culture is an enormous arrow pointing, go this way. And you know what lies that way? Impoverishment, madness, degradation, and death. That's where the culture is pointing. You can see it. You can see it. Just look where we're headed. If everyone on Earth aspires to the kind of lifestyle that you people can enjoy by virtue of having paid the money to be at a scene like this, there isn't enough glass, metal, and plastic in the planet to make that many Celicas and jaguars and bluebirds and snowbirds and all the rest of this crap. So what is needed is an awakening. Now, I mentioned earlier in this talk that in the 50s, before they interfered with LSD research, they were curing chronic alcoholism with a single 500 gamma dose of LSD. Well, now, for heaven's sake, nobody is suggesting that LSD is a cure for alcoholism. That, to me, is absurd. It's not a cure for alcoholism. It's a cure for stupidity. And a person who is killing themselves by drinking themselves to death takes 500 mics of LSD and says, what a stupid person I am. I'm killing myself. And so then they look at their behavior and they cease that behavior. And this is what has to be done on a societal scale. And it is not as difficult as we may wish to be assured by...
And you just had some...